Vir die meeste Suid-Afrikaners is 'n houtstomp iets waarmee daar vuur gemaak word. Maar nie vir Tony Frederiksen van Witrivier in Mpumalanga nie. Hy is 'n beeldhouer wat uitsluitlik met dryfhout werk. En een van hierdie stukke hout kan dalk net die inspirasie vir sy volgende meesterstuk wees.
Tien jaar gelede het Tony begin om beelde uit dryfhout te maak en dit het sy loopbaan in 'n heel ander rigting gestuur. Hy was steeds beeldhouer, maar sy medium is nou deur die elemente daar buite gevorm. En as kunstenaar moes hy die regte lyne en teksture vind om so stukkies van 'n legkaart in mekaar te pas.
There's nothing more satisfying than wood. What I found with the wood is that it's all got different textures. So This is sort of like a shrub, but it almost looks like it's mechanical.
Yeah.
En raai wie Tony se vriende? Die kevers en termiete wat die verrottende hout verorber en so aan elke stomp 'n unieke vorm gee.
Nobody knows they're there. When I go and I look for a tree, I might find it on the side of the road. Most of those shapes, the tree dies. Then the termites get into it while it's rotting away, and then they do all these channels and pathways, and they create all those lovely shapes. And then the tree, as it's dying, it's full of earth. So when you take out a dead tree, then you scrub out all the soil, and you find all these beautiful shapes that the termites have made inside. And then there's also beetles. The beetles also play a part. You can see this is some of my wood I find from dams where the water level drops. It's been underwater, so there's different effects. Different insects do things, create patterns that are, you know, they live in the water cycle. The longhorn beetles and your wood borer, they make different size holes in the wood, so you can end up with a pattern. If I can find one, yeah, there's some there. It's almost like a wafer thin,
yeah.
But you can have that full of holes, and it looks like a maybe something that I could use for like an insect's wings. So the insects play a very important role.
In Tony se hande word 'n stuk hout 'n kunswerk. 'N visarend, 'n haldekoker, 'n vis of dansers.
The hardest subject matter is humans, like dancers, and for them I use guava wood, which is quite surprising. Guava has a very smooth wood and it's got lovely gentle curves and knuckles, and that's ideal for like your dancers. Some of the private game farms, they don't burn, so you end up with very old pieces of wood.
Wow.
So you can see this one, the termites have eaten everything out and you're just left with these shells.
Yeah, it looks like a puffer fish.
Yes, that actually is a puffer fish. Yeah, that would make a wonderful fish. So I just add the eyes to that and then I look for fins, depending on what kind of wood it is.
Mens kan maar net wonder hoe ver hierdie stuk hout gedryf het en hoe lank dit onder die water was voordat Tony dit in 'n dammie naby ontdek het. En wat dit op die ou end in een van sy beeldhouwerke gaan word. Tony, what do you think?
Bertus, this piece of wood is a piece of bark. It was 30 years underwater in a
30
dam.
30 years.
30 years.
Ja.
The dam burst and then we found the piece of wood and this will become probably a crocodile. It's got beautiful texture for crocodile skin.
Absolutely.
Hout wat op die strand uitgespoel het, is deur die beweging van golwe afgewerk. Terwyl die wat in die binneland opgetel word, 'n ruwer voorkoms het. Die beeld van 'n wahoo is vir 'n hotelgroep in die Seychelles gemaak. En toe vra hulle Tony om 'n kolossale projek aan te pak waarvoor baie dryfhout nodig was. Hy moes 'n 13 meter lange beeld van 'n boggelrug walvis skep. Die walvis het 'n kenmerkende liggaamsvorm met lang borsvinne en 'n knobbelrige kop. Die projek het 5 weke geneem om te voltooi. 'n 3 meter lange selekant was volgende op die lys. Elke liggaamsdeeltjie perfek in verhouding.
So, how do you ensure accurate dimensions?
Okay, what I do is how I start is say I found something that's inspired me. So, this is the ear of a pig.
Ah.
Okay, so I start with that ear and then I sketch out the entire subject
okay.
to that scale. So that's my size of my pig's ear. Then I realized I know what size I've got to make the feet. The eyes are also quite important. That could be the eye of maybe a reptile of some sort. Mm. And that could be a mammal, just yeah. the cheekbone. And so the expression is in the eye. The expression is all determined by the pieces of wood I find. So if say for instance here, you can see that's like a finger of a man's finger.
Yes,
so
yes.
So now you might look at it at all different angles, yeah. but I've suddenly seen a finger in there. So that would be now like the start of a sculpture.
So do you always see the shape in the wood, or do you sometimes start off with a idea or a picture and then you go look for wood that would fit?
It's actually both ways. I start looking for wood for that particular theme, like the body world sculpture. There's lots of wood that when it's in like say a dam and there's wave action and there's sand pockets on the side of the dam, the wood rolls around in that sand and you get these beautiful round pieces, so they look like organs. That's what I used on the shark's organs. So then if I want to do like a human figure, then I'll start looking for pieces that look like that subject.
Dit het al gebeur dat Tony nie 'n beeld kon klaar maak nie omdat daar een stukkie hout te kort was. Hy kon dit in sy verbeelding sien en het presies geweet hoe dit moet lyk. Maar kon nie daai oog of daai klou tussen al hierdie stukke hout opspoor nie.
If you can't find a piece to fill a gap in one of your sculptures, what do you do?
Okay. I pray a lot. I think it's quite miraculous sometimes that what I do find in the wood.
Do you build in stories and symbolism into your sculptures?
Not really. I just celebrate creation, so everything in creation.
En dis duidelik te sien in elkeen van Tony Frederiksen se beeldhouwerke.